Here's another interesting fact. If Pakistan were to spare less than one-fifth of its military budget, it can run a program of universal education, meaning literacy for all, every child at school. Clearly, Islamabad does not intend to do that, more importantly, Rawalpindi. But this is something that many critics are highlighting, including former Pakistani ambassador to the US, Hussain Haqqani. He speaks the truth. He's been highlighting the problems in Pakistan, and he's now being hounded in his own country because he's highlighting these facts. He's turned from an establishment man to a bitter critic of Pakistan. He knows the system in his country. He's been part of it. And so when he speaks, his word carries weight. We spoke to him about India-Pakistan ties. We also asked him why he calls Pakistan a resilient international migraine. Hello and welcome to the interview. With me is a very special guest today, one of Pakistan's most famous diplomats and one of the most prominent critics, would I say, of the current dispensation, Mr. Hussain Haqqani. Let's start with what's happening between India and Pakistan. Would you say that ties are at an all-time low today, with the diplomats being allegedly harassed and things going the way they are? There are no talks.
The misfortune of Pakistan-India relations is that there have been far too many occasions when people have said the relationship is an all-time low. The fact of the matter is that we are now at a rather juvenile phase of the relationship, because when you think that ringing somebody's doorbell at 3 a.m. is the way to advance statecraft, you are not really advancing statecraft. I think India and Pakistan are at a very difficult moment, but not necessarily an all-time low. It can go lower, God forbid. At the end of the day, Pakistan has to take into account India's very genuine concerns about terrorism. And India has to recognize that Pakistan has a lot of difficulties that it is trying to deal with, or maybe not dealing with effectively. So India has to show some patience while Pakistan can reimagine itself, while Pakistan definitely has to act very quickly on the issue of terrorism. And both sides have to recognize that acting like little children in harassing each other's diplomats and not behaving like modern states is not going to advance the relationship.
You say India must show patience. It's been 70 years. Isn't it asking a bit too much of India, given the fact that the man who perpetrated the worst terror attack in India, on Indian soil, is a man who's making a political entry in Pakistan? The fact that cross-border terrorism continues, the fact that some would say the Indian Prime Minister put his best foot forward and Pakistan possibly
you probably know my views on that. I personally feel that Pakistan is shooting itself in the foot by allowing Hafiz Saeed to continue to operate and to give him political space. As far as the question of patience is concerned, India is a 5,000-year civilization and a 5,000-year-old country. 70 years is just a very small blip in India's history. On the other hand, Pakistan is only a 70-year-old country. So while people like me question a lot of Pakistani policies, I also at the same time advise my friends in India that do not get swayed by the daily news cycle the way countries with a short history are much more easily prone to do. There will be an India long after all these little episodes are gone. And so it's important to have the long view rather than look at everything only from the point of view of the daily news cycle.
Would you say that the Indian Prime Minister tried with
the oath-taking
ceremony
and Pakistan
did not make the...
I hope you are familiar with my views. I think that in this particular instance, the Indian Prime Minister, and not only the current Prime Minister, but the preceding Prime Minister as well, they have tried very hard. And unfortunately, Pakistan has not been as responsive as it could have been or should have been.
You've also made a point that Pakistan seems to have convinced itself of its indispensability in the war against terror. But over the past 1 year, we've seen some tough statements from America. We've seen aid being cut. Donald Trump is walking the talk, albeit slowly, according to India. But would you say that there is a certain degree of disillusionment now in Rawalpindi?
I think that what Rawalpindi and Islamabad both have to come to terms with is that the world never has endless patience. You pushed me back when I suggested that India needs to have patience, which was a statement in a very specific context of diplomats and how to treat each other in normal intercourse of nations. But the world has trusted Pakistan, mistrusted Pakistan, trusted it again, and then found that the promises are not being kept, especially on the question of dealing with terrorist safe havens. And I think that the United States is no longer willing to trust Pakistan's assurances without verification. But it's not just the United States. In the Financial Action Task Force, a lot of other countries said that Pakistan has given assurances before and not cracked down on terrorist funding. So, and then above all, having jihadi groups in Pakistan is basically inviting trouble for Pakistan. So Pakistan should have acted, and it should have acted in its own interest. The fact that the Pakistani deep state decided that, no, this is not our interest. Our interest is in protecting those people whom the rest of the world considers as terrorists, has placed Pakistan in a position where Pakistan's strategic location and Pakistan's availability as a strategic partner to the world's major powers is not going to be enough for Pakistan to be able to maintain itself the way it has become accustomed to maintaining itself.